Good morning, YouTube. You had questions, I have answers. Let's do this.
Where are you from?
So, I don't personally feel like I belong to any country in particular. I have no sense of national identity. I was born in the southern UK. I have spent the majority of my life in the United States, mostly in the New England area, and I'm currently residing in Scotland.
Will you make a video on insert video topic here?
More than likely, yes.
Will you showcase one of your Conlangs?
Yes, I will. A lot of people have been requesting this, so I'm going to feature one of my Conlangs in the next video I make, which should be up in a few weeks.
What languages do you speak? How's your Nahuatl coming?
So regrettably, at this point, the only language that I can speak comfortably is English. Sin embargo, puedo hablar solo un poco de español, y aunque para mí es muy fácil, porque muchas de las palabras es muy semejante a inglés, todavía hecho muchos errores de gramática y estructura. 我可以说这是一点点的普通话，但是我的声音是很不好，因此我跟中国人说话，没有，我听不懂很多次了。Ben de sadece biraz Türkçe konuşuyorum. Ama benim için çok zor bir dil. Çünkü çok İngilizceden çok farklı. Niman aşkan ninomachtiani nawatlatolli, apmukwali ni tlatoa, pampa achitsinka? Achitsinka itech ni tlatoa.
What's your language learning bucket list? Would you consider learning any conlangs?
So beyond getting to a conversational level in the languages that I can already kind of speak, I'd really like to be able to speak some of my favorite languages. Problem is, though, that a lot of my favorite languages, like Navajo and Basque and Georgian, are really intimidating to try and learn, so I might have to put those on the back burner. I'm actually really ashamed at how little I know about German, Japanese, and the Slavic languages in general, so I'd really like to learn some of those at some point. I also really want to get into Greek and Latin at some point. And this year, I have decided that I am going to get properly into Manchu, because I love Manchu, and it's comparatively not too difficult to learn. As for learning any conlangs to fluency, that's never been particularly appealing to me. Certainly not my own conlangs, because, number one, none of them are even remotely complete enough that I could learn to fluency. Number two, I just wouldn't see the point of being able to speak a language that no one else in the entire world speaks, or even recognizes as a language. As for other conlangs, I can't really say I'm that fussed. If I absolutely had to learn a conlang, it would probably just be, like, Sindarin or Quenya or something. On the other hand,
what are your thoughts on international auxiliary languages?
The reason I talk almost exclusively about naturalistic languages on this channel is because that's the only kind of conlang that I have any experience in making. I applaud the ambitions of international auxiliary languages, although I'm not actually sure if they'll ever achieve that goal, but hey, it's worth trying. And I can't personally say that I'm bothered to try and learn any of them. With one notable exception.
What do you think of Tokipona?
So I've actually been wanting to get into Tokipona for a long, long time now. Because, I mean, the main thing that attracts me is the fact that it's so incredibly minimalistic. I feel like if I had a free weekend at some point, I could probably memorize the bulk of the vocabulary. So I'll probably get around to learning that at some point this year, actually.
What's your educational background? Do you have any qualifications in linguistics?
I obtained a degree in zoology from the University of Edinburgh. Everything I know about linguistics and conlanging, I just taught myself just because I was interested.
How did you get into conlanging?
So I kind of covered this in the My First Conlang video. Basically, I had a world that I was working on, and I was inspired by Tolkien's Elvish to try and create my own language for it. And it started out as just a very rudimentary sort of naming language type thing, but then I progressively added more and more vocabulary, and I just used the grammar of Latin, because that was the only grammar that I was familiar with at the time. But then once I was exposed to Turkish, I just thought it was so cool the way the system worked that I included all of those grammatical features, and then I moved on to Finnish and some other languages and just kept pulling things from all of those until it ended up as a total mess. But then, once that project fell apart, I kept going trying to make better languages, and I just sort of kept doing it since then.
Do you do any world building besides conlanging?
Yes, I do. Conlanging is just one very small part of the world building process. I've been considering branching out and making videos related to other world-building topics. The thing is, though, I think between Artifexian and world-building notes, I don't really have very much to add to the whole world-building conversation. The only other topic besides conlanging that I feel like I have any kind of expertise or experience with is speculative biology, xenobiology, and creating fictional alien life forms and ecosystems, etc. Thing is, though, I have no idea how large the cross section is between people who like conlanging and people who like biology. I have no idea how big the middle of that Venn diagram would be. So do let me know in the comments below if you'd be interested in seeing videos about speculative biology or just general world building stuff.
What are your favorite and least favorite sounds in the IPA?
My favorites would be the voiceless dental fricative tha and the voiceless lateral fricative sla. I think those both sound really nice. As for least favorite sounds, I kind of have a bias against voiced obstruents in general, especially labial obstruents. When I'm conlanging, I will get rid of those if I possibly can. And if we're including non-pulmonic sounds, then I really can't stand implosives.
What are some of your favorite grammatical features?
I really, really like head marking, specifically polypersonal agreement. I also love noun case, but if I absolutely had to choose between noun case and polypersonal agreement, because it's kind of weird for a language to have both, I think I might have to go with polypersonal agreement, just because I don't like pronouns. I don't like stray pronouns floating around the sentence. Generally, I don't like little particles cluttering up the sentence. So I tend to prefer a reasonably high degree of synthesis. I love compounding, and I love noun incorporation. They're just so useful. I would, however, challenge any conlangers out there to intentionally omit some of their favorite features from the language that they're working on, because I think you'll actually be surprised how much you like the results. That was the design decision behind one of my languages, Okalawak, because up until that point, all of my languages felt kind of samey, because they all had a high degree of synthesis, they all had polypersonal agreement, they all had heavy compounding and noun incorporation. And so for Okalawak, I specifically challenged myself to not include those things. And I was really, really surprised with how much I liked the results.
What's your favorite writing system?
In terms of sheer aesthetics, I'd have to go with the Mongolian script, which I just think looks beautiful. But I do think that Glagolitic deserves a lot more attention. It looks like something out of an alchemist's textbook. In terms of system, however, it would have to be a tie between Sinhalese and Tibetan. Now, don't get me wrong, that's to say nothing about Tibetan's actual ability to reflect the spoken language in the written language. That's an entirely different thing. Just in terms of how glyphs are constructed, I think that's just a really neat system.
What's your favorite color?
Lime green.
Have you considered creating a Patreon?
Yeah, I've thought about it. I don't really know when creating one would be an appropriate thing to do, but I'll probably get that set up at some point later in the year.
Do you have any resources on grammatical evolution?
I would recommend The Evolution of Grammar by Joan Bybee et al. Or you could also have a look at The Art of Language Invention by David J. Peterson, which is essentially a less technical, more user-friendly version of this. But my absolute number one recommendation would be The World Lexicon of Grammaticalization by Bernd Hein. which sadly I still don't have a physical copy of. It goes through the lexical source of every point of grammar you can imagine, case markers, tenses, you name it.
Have you looked at Klingon? And if so, what do you think of it?
So here's a story that I actually omitted from the My First Conlang video for the sake of time. At a fairly early stage of Thandian's development, I came across a video of Mark Okrand explaining the development of Klingon, and specifically the way the verbs work with the prefix that encodes both the subject and the object. And that absolutely blew my mind, because I had never ever conceived of object marking as being a thing. And I was so insanely envious of this, that I hadn't thought of this idea, that I justified it to myself by saying, oh, there's no way that could happen in a natural language. No, this is clearly something that Mark Okrand has just made up and thrown in there to make the language seem more weird and alien. No, my language is better than Klingon because I don't stoop to such a low level as to include such a ridiculous, unnaturalistic thing as marking for the object. Because my language, it's so perfectly naturalistic. And then about a month later, I first encountered classical Nahuatl, which, if you know anything about the way Nahuatl works, it has subject marking and object marking and indirect object marking and adpositional marking and all sorts of other marking. And that was the second big revolution in my understanding of how language could work. The first one was Turkish, the second one was Nahuatl, and that's how Nahuatl became my favorite language. But anyway, on the subject of Klingon itself, Klingon seems to be fairly polarizing to me. I know a lot of people who really love it, most of them Star Trek fans, and I've seen a lot of Conlangers who really don't seem to like it very much. I think I'm a little bit more forgiving of it than a lot of people because I know that the original intention behind its creation was just to generate lines of dialogue for Star Trek III. There was no pretense of it being a full language that you could carry on philosophical conversations with and translate Hamlet into. And I know a lot of people who say, it's weird for the sake of being weird. If you look at the phonology, it's completely asymmetrical, all sorts of stuff like that, but it's Star Trek. A lot of stuff in Star Trek doesn't make any sense, so I think it's fine.
What does the name of your channel mean?
So when I started the channel, I knew I wanted it to be educational, and I wanted to discuss linguistics, because that's just what I was inspired to talk about at the time. So I put the Lang at the end, and I wanted to signify the channel as being a sort of catalogue of information, like a reference grammar or like a book. So I tried to think of a cool word for book. And what better excuse than to use possibly my favorite Greek word, Biblaridion? And it's my favorite Greek word because it has three, count 'em, three diminutives on it. So the original word for book, way, way back in ancient Greek, was bublos, which was the name of the place in Lebanon that they got the papyrus for making scrolls. Then that got appended with a diminutive to make a word for paper, which was biblion. And then through successive waves of semantic bleaching, more diminutives were applied, so it went from biblion to biblarion to biblaridion. The last four syllables of that word are just diminutives stacked on top of each other. That's awesome.
How does one keep being motivated to continue creating a language?
First of all, never feel like you need to conlang. If you don't enjoy your hobby, then why are you doing it? Only invest as much energy into a project as you feel you want to. Assuming you're doing this for a world-building project, there's always going to be some area of a created world that's lacking in detail, depending on where your interests lie and which areas you choose to flesh out in greater detail. And if you're concerned with the amount of time that you need to invest in conlanging, making a conlang doesn't actually have to take that much time. You could always just make a naming language or some more rudimentary thing with just a couple of words and phrases, and then you can always come back to and expand it later on if you feel like you want to. And if you feel like you're starting to not like your language or you feel like you're doing something wrong, know that that's completely normal. All of the conlangs that I currently work on have at least three or four different previous iterations that I scrapped and rebooted. It's just a part of the learning process, really. Just always keep in mind that you will improve and you will eventually get the language to a place that you like.
How do you make new routes? Do you use online generators?
No, I've never used an online generator. I've never had a reason to. When I'm making a new route, I will just come up with a phonological form that I think sounds appropriate and just go with it.
What method do you follow when learning languages? Does learning linguistics help?
I kind of subscribe to the Steve Kaufman school of language learning, which is essentially learning through exposure. The way I see it, the limiting factor in your ability to speak or understand a language is always, always, always going to be the number of words that you know. So my focus is almost entirely on learning vocabulary, and I think the best and most efficient and definitely the funnest way to do that is by learning from authentic, compelling content. So, for example, from my Turkish library, I have Delili'in Dağlarında, which is At the Mountains of Madness in Turkish. This is one of my favorite books, by the way. I've also got from Tolkien, Hurin'in Çocukları, The Children of Hurin, which is a great book. I have also got Hobbit. It's just called Hobbit, which is, as you might expect, The Hobbit. This will probably give you some insight into what types of books I like. So what I do is literally just read through those books. My favorite language learning website is Link, that's LINGQ.com, which is essentially just an assisted reader where you can import content in the target language into the system, and it translates whichever word you highlight, and you can save words and phrases to a database and all sorts of stuff like that. It's very useful. As for the importance of learning linguistics in language learning, it's definitely useful, but it's by no means mandatory. Even as a person who's quite interested in grammar and linguistics, etc., I never go into a language grammar first, unless I wanted just a general, broad overview of it beforehand. But I'll only look up grammatical things if I'm stuck on a particular point. If a certain structure keeps appearing and I don't understand why it's like that, I will go and look up a grammatical explanation.
What's the most abnormal natural language slash language feature that you've come across?
So in part two of my How to Make a Language series, I mentioned that I'd never seen a language that doesn't have na, and some people actually wrote back and pointed me in the direction of iao, which I'm probably not pronouncing right, which I looked up, and yes, it does not in fact have any phonemic nasals, which is very weird, but also very cool. But I think the one that takes the cake would probably be the fact that Arapaho does not have phonemic r. There's almost certainly some sort of allophonic thing going on that I'm just not aware of, but I mean, no r? It's the easiest, most common sound in the world. You literally just open your mouth and engage the vocal cords.
Make a sound one can't describe with IPA.
This has actually been bugging me for a while because I don't know what ra is. I'm not sure if you'll be able to hear that properly, but it's ra. It's like va, except you don't use the lips. It's like a ra, like a bidental fricative, I guess? I don't know. Someone with more knowledge on phonetics, please tell me what that is.
I wanted to make a conlang with some unique and kind of random sounds. I added ah, but I'm not sure if I should add anything else with it. Any thoughts on that?
Well, to make it symmetrical, you could throw in other epiglottal or pharyngeal sounds like ha or ra or something like that. For further weird sounds, I would strongly recommend looking into phonation changes like creaky voice and breathy voice and stuff like that because I think they're pretty underrepresented in a lot of naturalistic conlangs. However, I would also say that phonotactics is just as important as the phonetic inventory in giving a language its phonetic character. You can make a language with a really vanilla phonetic inventory sound really weird if you do the phonotactics right. Like in one of my conlangs, Ulazrulun, the phonetic inventory isn't anything special, but the phonotactics allow for some pretty extreme clustering to take place. So you end up with some really weird sounding words like ftan and achh.
How many conlangs and even conscripts have you made so far?
It depends on how you count, because I've made at least 2 or 3 dozen sketches for languages that were just either to just play around with ideas, or they never achieved critical mass to, necessary to become a full-fledged Conlang. And as I've mentioned, all of the languages that I'm currently working on have many previous iterations that I scrapped. It also depends on if you count dialects and sister languages as being part of the same language or as separate ones. So all in all, at the moment, I have 6 language families that I'm working on, but if you include all of the languages that I've ever made, it would be something like in the 20s, I guess. Unfortunately, however, I've only made, I think, 4 or 5 actual complete functional conscripts.
What music do you like, and do you play any instruments?
I freely admit that I have no taste in music. Not simply a bad taste in music, a distinct absence of a taste in music. To me, it's all just noise. Of the few songs that I do listen to, they're very eclectic and random and tied to specific personal experiences that I associate them with. The only 2 musicians that I actually follow are Fear of Dark and Protodome, and both of them produce chiptunes, which is one of the only genres of music that I actually reliably like.
If there existed a fantasy world with a magic language which is used to chant spells, how do you think the natural language would be affected by this?
Assuming that the magic language works in the form of you say a certain word or phrase and then some magical effect follows, then that has a number of implications. First and foremost, that means that the magic language is not a prescriptive language, it's a descriptive language. And what I mean by that is that all of the natural languages that exist in the real world are prescriptive languages. When I say a word like dog, then English speakers will understand what I'm referring to because we have collectively agreed that that sequence of sounds refers to the entity that we call a dog. But that's not set in stone, as evidenced by the fact that there are, you know, many other natural languages that don't call them dogs. And even if we just look at English, sound changes can take place, words' meanings can shift, maybe the word, I don't know, puppy in the future just overtakes the word dog, and now what the word dog becomes just an archaic word that no one uses anymore. Things can change like that. However, in a hypothetical magic language, let's say you have a root ta that means fire, so that when you use the word ta in some utterance, then some magical effect relating to fire happens. That means that that word, ta, is not prescriptive. It's not something that people have agreed upon relates to fire. It's an intrinsic fact of the universe that that word means fire. So that means that if this is a spoken language and sound changes apply, let's just say voicing of the first segment of a word so it becomes da, da doesn't mean fire. It might mean something else, but it doesn't mean fire. So if people say da instead of ta, then either a different effect or no effect at all happens. That would actually be kind of a fun spin on the whole magic is dying trope. Magic is dying because people have stopped pronouncing the incantations correctly. That's kind of funny. But for the structure of the language itself, I would recommend looking into oligosynthetic languages and philosophical languages like Lingua Philosophica, and I think Awi also has a similar system where individual phonemes stand for certain aspects of the universe that are combined in various ways to produce whatever meaning you're intending.
Say that I've already established all phonological and grammatical shift my language has, using, say, 200 words to help set it in stone. What if I want to add more vocab in? Words come from differing time periods and should thus evolve differently, yes? How might you tackle this?
In general, if you want more words, I would just advise going down the derivational pathway, just making more kinds of derivational affixes. In particular, you mentioned words coming from different time periods, and for that, I would always keep in mind the productivity of your affixes. If you think about an affix like the English suffix "-n", like "-eaten", or "-rotten", or "-laden", Back in the day, that was quite productive and used with lots of different words, but these days, we can't make new words using that suffix. So I would say start out with an original set of derivational affixes that you derived from affixed independent words, and then use them to derive new words up to a point, and then for later periods in history, at some point just stop using those derivational affixes and derive new ones from whatever independent words exist in the language at that point, and then make a new set of derivational affixes. But you can keep the older forms with the now fossilized derivational affixes kicking around, and that will help make your lexicon much larger and make it a lot more naturalistic. All right, thank you very much to everyone who submitted questions. I will try to address everyone's linguistics-related questions in future videos. I'm considering stealing, I mean, co-opting Artifexian's format and maybe doing a Q&A every couple of videos or so just to catch up with people and address any questions that they might have about the topics I cover. Other than that, I will see you in the next video. Thanks very much for watching.